Welcome everybody to the European launch of Earth Overshoot Day. Earth Overshoot Day will be on August 22nd. I'm Mathis Wackernagel with Global Footprint Network, and it's an honor to have you all here. And I would like just to start to thank the Club of Rome for co-hosting this event, and particularly Laura and Till, who did enormous work to bring everybody together. As a member of the Club of Rome myself, I'm particularly honored to do this launch together. And we'll have Sandrine Dixon de Cleve, co-president of Club of Rome, who will moderate and also use this occasion together with Johan Rockström to launch the second edition of the Planetary Emergency Plan. So thank you so much for joining. Before we start, let me give you just some context. We say Earth Overshoot Day. That's what's that? That's from January 1st to August 22nd. Humanity has used as much as Earth can renew in the entire year. And how do we know that? Pretty simply, we look at all the human demands that compete for the ecologically productive spaces of the planet, for food, for fiber, for energy, to accommodate our houses and our roads, to absorb CO2 emissions, etc. That all competes for space. And then we can compare that space with how much is available on the planet. About a quarter of the surface of the planet is ecologically productive. And on a per capita basis, that means about 12.3 billion hectares of ecologically productive space on our planet. And so per person, currently about 1.6 hectares of ecologically productive space. If we compare that with our use today and add up all the uses, it's bigger, about 2.5 global hectares per person. How can it be that it's bigger? It's like with money, we can spend more than what we earn, but not forever. And so we can translate that, and we can translate it into number of planets that we use. Because if you use 1.6-fold or 60% faster what Earth can renew, it's like using 1.6 Earth. And then we can translate this number and say, by when in the year, if you use 60% more rapidly the resources, by when in the year have you used the entire budget for the year? And it turns out to be August 22nd this year. And that's what we call Earth Overshoot Day. And the main message is not just Earth Overshoot Day, but rather that we can move the date. And by moving the date, we are moving ourselves in a more secure and safe position. If you look at the trends over time, the green part shows how much of the year has been covered by regeneration, and the red part is how much it comes from depletion. And we just see in the last year, because of COVID, the part that is covered by regeneration is higher. We reduced the overall demand by about 10%, and that's what delayed Earth Overshoot Day this year compared to last year, about 3 weeks. Now, it's not something to celebrate because that comes with some suffering. It's not done by design, it's done by disaster. And that's why we need good plans to move forward. And I think the Planetary Emergency Plan that we're discussing here is exactly what's needed to move the date. Now, they use a better word than just saying move the date. They call it emergence from emergency, and recognize also the embedment that it's embedded also in political and social systems. But before we do the launch, I would love to welcome also the little message that we got from our friends at WWF, Pavan Sukdev and Marco Lambertini, who sent us a little message. Can we play the message? I think Laura would play. Here we go.
Greetings. My name is Pavan Sukdev. I'm the president of WWF International. And I'm welcoming you on what is known as Earth Overshoot Day, sadly. It is the day on which we, humanity, have collectively consumed everything that the planet had to produce. And we are literally now having consumed the interest on natural capital, starting to eat into natural capital itself. In other words, we are living now off the capital and not the interest of this planet's production. this won't do. Huge problems, climate change, biodiversity loss, ecosystem degradation are around us. What we need to do is to consume in a manner that ensures human development is maintained, but at the same time ensures that we don't have a problem on the Earth's biocapacity. Our per capita footprint has to be less than and not greater than the Earth's biocapacity. And if we draw this on a graph, you will see that the future of good development has to be such that all countries move into this right-hand corner box in which right now nobody is. The developed world will have to move down in terms of per capita footprint. In other words, they will have to ensure that their ecological footprint is reduced. The developing world will have to engage a strategy of green development, which means achieving higher human development without taxing the planet's capacity to meet our needs. Today, we have managed to consume the Earth's resources for this year slightly later than we did last year. But Marco, is that a good thing or a bad thing?
My name is Marco Lambertini. I'm Director General of WWF International. Pavan, it is a good thing, but it is a good thing for the wrong reason, because it shouldn't really take a global pandemic to make us manage more sustainably the resources of the planet. And if you look at the situation, when the whole pandemic started, in a few weeks, the virus already brought our economy and society on its knees, affecting particularly the most vulnerable. And since then, it's continued to provoke havoc into the way we live our lives. And so we all hope, and actually there are some encouraging signs, that we're beginning to learn the lesson of what this pandemic has brought into focus, which is our unsustainable, wasteful, destructive, frankly, relationship with nature, with the planet. And so in building back better, or in building a better future, I would say, we should be really thinking of decoupling exactly what you just mentioned, decoupling economic development from an environmental degradation, so we can develop, but not at the expenses of the planet, because we know that a planet in crisis is a society in crisis and an economy in crisis. And so that's what we advocate in WWF, a vision for a carbon neutral and nature positive economy, an economy that respects the climate, respects the other Earth systems and biodiversity. And next year we have a great opportunity to achieve that through a number of commitments and investments the governments and corporations, particularly supported by the public, would actually be able to bring to fruition. So we call it the super year for nature and people. And hopefully that this pandemic, it will be about stronger awareness and stronger commitment to a sustainable future.
And this is why we all look forward to what is being referred to now as the New Deal for Nature and People, one in which all countries, all segments of society commit to achieving human development, but without taxing the Earth's ability to meet our needs. Living in harmony with nature is the mission of WWF. And we hope that you will join us in achieving this mission by containing our ecological footprint.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Marco and Pavan, for this wonderful message. And I would like now to invite our host for today, Sandrine Dixon de Cleve, co-president of the Club of Rome, to take over and start with the segment about launching this wonderful update of the Planetary Emergency Plan.
Thank you so much, Mathis. And thank you again to everyone that's joined us this morning early at this very important time on Earth Overshoot Day. And I'm going to pass immediately to Johan Rockström, who's really been my partner in crime in developing this Planetary Emergency Plan, which very much as laid out by yourself and also Pavan and Marco, talks about a new deal for people, nature, and climate. And what this plan is very much doing is trying to bring in the human dimension. The months that we've gone through now as we move through this COVID period of trying to understand the convergence of the tipping points between a human pandemic or a health pandemic and the climate change, biodiversity loss, shocks that we're in the midst of. So Johan, I'm passing over to you, and then I will come back and continue the session.
Thanks, Sandrine, and hello everyone. And I to start with, this is a really important moment we have now to try and revive the super year 2020 into what now has become the the substitute of that, which is the tipping point we need to achieve in 2021 towards a transformation. And let me just lay out the science behind why define a planetary emergency, which then should kick off an emergence plan towards a sustainable, prosperous, and equitable future. Now, there are three elements to this. The first one is of course, that we at 1.2 degrees Celsius warming, at the midst of the sixth mass extinction of species on Earth, with the great acceleration of exponential pressures on essentially all parameters that matter for human well-being, we start feeling the indent on humans and economies and jobs and equity. And, you know, I don't have to spend much time, but I think it is good to just remind ourselves, because it feels so long time ago in the midst of the COVID crisis, that Australia had the most unprecedented forest fires ever recorded, with devastating, catastrophic impacts on humans and biodiversity, but also leading to a pulse of 900 million tons of carbon dioxide, which is more than twice the annual emissions of fossil fuel burning in Australia over an entire year. So here you have nature tipping over from being our best friend, being a sink of carbon, to becoming a pulse of carbon. Just very far away from Australia in Siberia, 38 degrees Celsius was measured this summer, never occurred before, leading to extreme forest fires, permafrost thawing, disease patterns, pulses of carbon. You have the heat waves across the European Union. We have the floods in Bangladesh hitting millions. We have the super configuration of multiple factors in Kenya with desert locust invasions and drought and food riots in the midst of the COVID crisis. These kind of perfect storms that are now no longer, you know, extremes, they are increasingly part of normality. So that's one element of the emergency. But the most important part of the emergency is what you started off with, Mathis, when you said 22nd of August is the day when we have actually consumed the annual productive capacity of the Earth system and we go on credit. Well, you said we can do that. Sure, up to a certain point, but then it crashes. You can go on credit up to a certain point. The latest science, I mean, now I'm talking 48 hours ago, showed again science pointing at the fact that the Greenland ice sheet may already have crossed a tipping point, that the credit point has already passed, that we are on an irreversible trajectory, potentially on Greenland. We know we are on an irreversible trajectory on the Arctic sea ice. We have also passed a tipping point in the Thwaites Glacier on Antarctica, which means that fundamentally, if I would add all these tipping point risks from the Amazon to the Atlantic overturning of heat to the permafrost thawing, that the red thread of 20 years of scientific advancements is, quite frankly, that there's a need for self-critique. We have underestimated the pace of change. We've underestimated the interconnections between the different global commons in the Earth system, which means that you can get abrupt, irreversible, and accelerated change. You combine these two factors and we land at the conclusion that we're facing not only high risk, but potentially irreversible risk for humanity's possibilities to thrive on Earth. And then comes just the last point behind an emergency. When you think of it, what is it that defines an emergency? Well, one is risk, potentially irreversible catastrophic risk. We feel that we have unequivocally defined this. Secondly, is time. You never declare an emergency unless you're running out of time. Well, we have been struggling on this agenda since actually the Limits to Growth report of the Club of Rome in 1972. We have been trying and trying and trying and trying and made some success, but never really got the transformative moment. Now we've entered the decade when we have very strong scientific evidence that we need to cut global emissions by half and halt loss of biodiversity and go circular, restore and regenerate. This is the transformative moment, but it's not transformative moment over generations. It's a transformative moment over 10 years. It's like in a blink of time. So that is what takes us to an emergency point. And with all that scientific evidence, that conclusion is, of course, not isolated. It's not a conclusion to communicate to the world we have an emergency. It's to communicate to the world, let's put all hands on deck and act on the emergence agenda, which forms the plan that we've designed together with you, Sandrin, and your team at the Club of Rome. So I'll hand back to you to talk about the positives here. So I'll just conclude at that point. Over
Thank
to you.
Thank you, Johan. Thank you, Johan. It's difficult to talk about the positives clearly when we see the absolute urgency that we're in. But I think that the other clear point that the Club of Rome has been saying for the 50 last years and continues to say through the climate emergency plan that we published 2 years ago, the planetary emergency plan that we published together a year ago, and now our new version 2.0, which brings in the COVID pandemic as the important human dimension of planetary emergency. And the point here is exactly the point that was made by Mathis, which is that humanity has gone through crises before. This is not a singular crisis. This will be a cycle of crises. And what we need to remind humanity is that, yes, by pulling together, creating a sense of solidarity between North and South, between local and national, international governments, working together to ensure that we don't just look at this as one crisis, but the greatest crisis with regard to humanity. This is a man-made, human-made crisis, which we are the only ones that can solve. So that brings us to transformation and emergence. We have learned through COVID, and exactly as was said before, that we can actually, some of us, pull together through disaster. But what we need to do now is design our way out. What the planetary emergency plan demonstrates is ways to do that. The immediacy of some of the calls to action that we need in the energy sector, in the materials sector, in the agriculture sector, looking at the nexus of the way in which we use land, water, energy, and air, looking at the nexus of the way as communities we interact between rural communities and urban communities. What COVID has done has brought people back to what is essential. And what our plan tries to demonstrate is that what is essential to humanity is actually access to our essentials, access to healthcare, access to food, water, access to employment, ensuring that we have greater equity and prosperity. We believe at the Club of Rome that there is prosperity without growth. We believe that growth actually is completely outdated, that a well-being economy is the economy that we need, and that this planetary emergency plan will enable us to put in place the economic and the financial underpinnings necessary to bring us to a well-being economy, an economy that services people, an ecosystem rather than an ego system. In today's world, where we are looking at fake facts, when we are looking at hate mongering by so many of our leaders and a total disrespect for human life, what we are trying to do collectively as a community through the Club of Rome, through the Potsdam Institute, through our network of partners, 220 partners, government officials, non-government officials, civil society coming together through the Planetary Emergency Partnership to ensure that we no longer think that we have 50 years to move into action. So what I would like to do now is move into some of the videos that we've been able to gather from policy officials and indicate very clearly as well that if you only see one woman on the screen for the moment, this was not the intention. As wonderful as these lovely men are, we have tried through our videos and as much as possible to bring in obviously the diverse community that we are, both in terms of gender diversity and obviously also voices from the North and South. But we are in Europe, and this is a European launch, and there are a series of other videos that will be distributed that are coming from across the world that actually Mathis and his team has been working on as well to bring those very dear messages that we all need to bring out at this important time. So Laura, can you please start the videos?
Earth Overshoot Day is a very important day, but at the same time, a very disturbing day, because it marks a day where we have already used all the materials for 1 year in only 2/3 of the year. So 8 months gone, 4 months to go, and we used all our materials. That's disturbing, and I'm very happy that the Club of Rome never ceases to draw attention to this, again in your new report, where you show the world what the crises are that we have to face right now, but you also show us what we can do about it, and we need to do it for ourselves, for the planet, and for our children. In Amsterdam, by the beginning of this year, we have adopted our roadmap, Amsterdam Climate Proof in 2050. And for 2030, we have set our goals for 55% reduction of CO2 emissions. And that's a hell of a job to do, but we know we can do it if we do it together. We're looking at our industry, we're looking at our built environment, we're looking at our mobility sector, but we're also looking at making much more green energies than we have right now by windmills and solar, etc. But we know we have to do more, because of course climate crisis is an ecological crisis, but it could also turn into a social crisis, where we see that people who have very little to spend will pay the highest price, because if the energy prices go up, they will be the one who can't afford it, and not everybody can pay for a Tesla. And we have to make sure that the tools that we have to fight climate crisis, we also use them to address all those social issues. And that's what we try to do with our circular program. The corona crisis has hit Amsterdam economically in a very hard way. We are a city of hospitality. We have a lot of tourists. We have a lot of congresses, international events. All that stopped at one point in March, and we lost a lot of income, and a lot of people are fearing for their jobs and fearing for unemployment. But we know that there's so much work to do in Amsterdam to make this a green and sustainable city. And the good thing is, a circular economy is an economy that needs huge amount of employment. Think about it, if you want to reuse stuff, if you want to recreate stuff, if you want to regenerate stuff, it all needs a lot of hands to work on that. If we want to build our windmills, if we want to build our infrastructures for green energies, and if we want to have all those solar panels on our roofs, that is a lot of employment that we need. And so this is the way we want to go as Amsterdam. We want to become a circular city. We're creating a lot of employment for people who used to work in other jobs. So we make it sure that they go from one job to the other. But we also want to invest in education, that younger people can really be educated to work in this green and social economy of Amsterdam. But we can't do that alone, because at this moment, labor has very high taxes, where at the same time, raw materials have very low taxes. So still, it is much cheaper for a company to make something new out of raw materials instead of recycling, reusing, and recreating or repairing old materials. So if we want to make that change, if we really want to invest in employment in this city and in the Netherlands, we need to make that change. Put higher taxes on raw materials and lower taxes on labor. That's our way out of this crisis in a sustainable way.
2020 has become a very strange year in the recent history. For the first time, we have got some delay in the Earth's Overshoot Day due to something we could have liked to miss. We don't like the reasons why this has come this way, but we understand that the planet has got an additional time to breathe. Now we know that it is important to take decisions based on science, to take into consideration the emergency, the urgency to react to something which is probably the worst threat on humankind for decades, for centuries, for years. And this is what we are trying to do here in Spain, as in many other countries, to think about our urban agenda, the mobility of the people and the mercantile and the trading and the merchandising, but also to think about the innovation, the industry, the way we produce and consume energy and other goods. And I guess that there are many things we can do. We can put put in place the regulatory framework through new legislation. We can think in the mid and long term, so to plan, to identify, to find out what are the main challenges we need to overcome and we need to take into consideration to create opportunities out of this situation. We need to think in the goals, in the targets we fix in our agenda for 2030, but also for 2050, where we should be absolutely out of the carbon economy. We should be absolutely decarbonized. We could need to be inspired by biodiversity ecosystems and the way nature works, so that we can identify what type of green investments, what type of green infrastructure, what type of ecosystem solutions we can put in place in order to facilitate our ecosystems to be much more adaptive and resilient to climate impacts. And I think that this is something we can make. People is demanding for that. The accent being put on what about the next generation is absolutely key. We have been over 50 degrees in Baghdad. We have witnessed terrible wildfires in Siberia. We are witnessing great heat waves all around the world, or the melting of the poles in a very short period of time, and the disparition of species in the wildlife. So I think that these are signals that we cannot keep on going as we used to do. At the same time, we have been an implosion. We have witnessed a great implosion of the price of oil, of the price of gas, deep value changes in our mindset, so to think in mobility in different terms, and we have learned that we can do things differently, but we need to do things differently for a different reason from the current one, just because we know that it is in our interest to invest in a different manner for a different future.
Good day. I'm very happy to be with you, though only virtually, on Earth Overshoot Day. We know we get together on this day to remind everyone that we are wasting our planet at an alarming rate. And this is also a means to counter our unfortunately extraordinary ability to ignore warning signs, often until it's too late. However, the good news, because there is some good news, is that we have not yet run out of time. We can still stop global warming. We can mitigate climate change, we can adapt to what we cannot avoid, and we can enable future generations to reverse it. To do it, we need the help of science and technology. We have most of it, and we need to invest in more. We need massive investment in new infrastructure and low carbon production. We need to change our economy to make zero carbon an integral part of how any business is run, of how our energy is produced, of how people and goods move. We need to put nature at the heart of this transformation and have farmers and foresters join conservationists in protecting our environment, our biodiversity, and enhancing our carbon sink. To those who say that we cannot afford to make those changes now, or we must first build back, the answer is that we cannot afford to build back without change. We do not have the resources to build back. We will borrow them from future generations. We cannot use these resources to rebuild something that will collapse around them. It would be like building a collapsed wooden house while all around fires are appearing. I would like to conclude by pointing out that this is not the first time that we borrow from future generations. For many of our countries, this is the origin of the massive debt that settles them. However, the recovery plan that the von der Leyen Commission has put forward, which has been endorsed by our heads of state and government, and which will be hopefully finalized soon by Council and Parliament, makes a radical change to this practice. We borrow from future generations to build a better future for them, and we make this a condition for spending those borrowed resources. This is the sense of the green recovery and of the slogan, build back better. And this is a serious answer to the youth movement's plea, you must act now, because when we will be in charge, it will be too late. Many of us will not see it, But let's pave the way to have one day an Earth Undershoot Day. Thank you for listening.
I think in the meantime, if you can hear me, I would like to just move it on. I think the next person would be Terry Ahern, CEO of the Scottish Environment Protection Agency. And they have used One Planet Prosperity as their overarching regulatory framework. And I would like to invite you, Terry, to explain us how that links to Earth Overshoot Day.
Thank you, Mathis. So what does a regulator do? Most nations have an environmental protection agency or something like that. What do we need to do? Well, in the past, what we've done is stop bad stuff happening. Our job has been to stop pollution from factories or runoff from farms. Is that good enough for the future? Absolutely not. If you think about the fact that Earth Overshoot Day is on Saturday, if you listen to the planetary emergency plan description, we need to fundamentally change what we do. It's not good enough to just stop bad stuff happening. We have to help good stuff happen. So in Scotland, as one example, we have signed a sustainability partnership agreement with 14 other partners, Scottish Enterprise, the government's economic development agency, Fife Council, which is the local authority for the area, Diageo, a drinks manufacturer, Keep Scotland Beautiful, a third sector organisation, the Forts Rivers Trust, group of volunteers who try and improve the river, and many others. This part of Scotland was one of the heartlands of the original high carbon industrial revolution. We brought these other 14 partners together to try and create a low carbon industrial revolution in that area. So our job needs to be, we will stop bad stuff happening. If the help that people need, if businesses need in Scotland, is a kick and a whack from the regulator, they'll get it. That's part of our job. But we need to be standing shoulder to shoulder with business, with the broader community, with the third sector, and saying we need to create a different economy and a different society. So we're looking at hydrogen innovation in this part of Scotland. We're looking at all sorts of things that will create a very different Scotland, starting there and working all over the nation. That's the role of the regulators. And we need to listen to the other speakers on this session and not take the easy way out and just do the policing job. We need to do it, that's really important, but we need to step up and change and get to the front and help people create the economy of the future. Thank you, Mathis.
Thank you so much, Terry, and apologies for dropping off. I really very much appreciate the work that Scotland is doing and your leadership as well as the First Minister's. And I'd like to congratulate you for really stepping up to the plate, also in demonstrating that post COVID, and we're still many of us in COVID, that Scotland has come out much more resilient because you have already started to de-risking your economy and looking at stranded assets and very much understanding that you need to move towards a well-being economy as one of the leaders in this area with some of the other governments. Another incredible woman like the First Minister is President von der Leyen of the European Commission. And I'd like now to introduce a very good friend and an incredible champion of change within the Commission, which is Kurt Vandenberg. Kurt is working both on COVID and the issues that COVID brings and also the European Green Deal. So for me, the embodiment of those tipping points and that convergence of our health pandemic with an incredible understanding of the risks coming from climate change and biodiversity loss. So Kurt, please.
Thank you very much, Sandrine, for this very kind introduction. Good morning to all. And I'd like to start by congratulating all those who have worked on Earth Overshoot and on the Planetary Emergency Plan. These are documents that are very well received and which we will certainly study very in depth. Earth Overshoot Day is, of course, an inconvenient but necessary yearly rendezvous. It's like a or fever meter, one of the many that we have, but a necessary one. But rather than being only a tracker, we should also make it a tool to help us push the date. And a little bit like Modo was saying, maybe move towards undershoot day indeed, without having regular yearly pandemics to get there. I agree with you, Sandrine, that COVID-19 has woken up a lot of people, woken up to the fragility of our economic and ecological ecosystems, but also the importance of the notion of commons, of common public goods in the healthcare system, for example. Hopefully, we will soon have, in a matter of months, maybe a year, a vaccine that will be a lasting solution to this pandemic. But unfortunately, and as you know better than anyone else, there is no vaccine against the erosion of our planetary ecosystem. And that's why we need to work on a decadal, generational agenda of systemic transformation. And what I think is particularly welcome in the Earth Overshoot work is that it really points to the core of the issue being the unsustainable levels and degrees of production and consumption of goods and services. It really makes the point, drives the point home, that it is more than just catering for clean energy or cleaning our energy systems. The key is really how we produce and consume goods and services. And that's why the circular economy, a circular regenerative economy, is so important. You know that the European Commission has come up with an action plan. We have put this at the heart of our industrial strategy, and this is really going to the core of what we need to do. The planetary emergency plan is also very welcome. It tells everyone how serious and urgent the situation is, as very eloquently exposed by Johan Rockström. And as the plan says, indeed, the next 12 months will be critical. It will be a super year, as Mr. Lambertini was saying, which will decide what the next decades will look like. For us in Brussels, at the European Union, it comes with the Next Generation EU, the recovery plan, with the incredible amount of finance that we will bring to bear, which will have to support the green and digital transitions or transformations, making us all more resilient. But it's going to be very important that we bounce back better beyond Brussels. So the ownership, the leadership, the innovation at national, local, regional levels will be so important. And that's why it was so good to hear about what Scotland is doing, which is indeed a champion. And innovating in this will be incredibly important. Secondly, what I would also like to mention is that next month, the Commission will come forward with our plan for the 2030 climate targets. We will increase the ambition beyond the 40% that we currently have in law. We will increase it to 50 or possibly 55%. I would call that the European Emergency Plan, which hopefully will also create a good momentum for the rest of the world. It is about climate, but of course it comes with a lot of other initiatives, building on what we've done in the past months on biodiversity, farm to fork, but I will not expand on all the other initiatives. There will be a train of the initiatives coming in the next months, and we hope that this will indeed create the momentum for a realization and ownership at international level, with big rendezvous waiting for us in Glasgow next year, but also on biodiversity. And climate and biodiversity go together. And if we can get the sustainable production and consumption right, on the right track, then I think, as Mauro was saying, it is not too late. We can do it. Thank you for the incredibly good work.
Thank you so much, Kurt. And really, the thank you goes back to the incredible leadership of the European Union. And as we've seen from all the videos and also Terry, you're right that also in Europe, there is a real desire to do the right thing. We see in Amsterdam the work that Kate Raworth, one of our top economists and members of the Club of Rome, has done in putting forward the donut in Amsterdam. We see the work that Scotland is doing on the well-being indicators. We see the work that Teresa Ribeiro is doing in Spain in trying to move that country forward as well. There is a great pull in Europe to do the right thing. And that's why it's very important to recognize also that in the last 2 years, the convergence of those who are working on these issues with the youth movement has fundamentally shifted the consciousness of leaders in Europe and across the globe, but very much in Europe. This morning, Adelaide, who's going to be actually our next speaker in a video, as one of the youth who's been leading the Fridays for the Future movement with Greta, with Louisa in Germany, and with Anuna here in Belgium, is meeting with Merkel. She cannot be with us because she is walking into the hallways of Merkel's office right now for an hour and a half meeting. Now, why is that important? First of all, as she said to me just a day ago, wow, we got an hour and a half, not 30 minutes. And we got an hour and a half with her, not with a whole bunch of people. The fact is, leaders are listening and they want to listen to the youth and the next generation to set the tone of what needs to be done. Adelaide has also become an advisor to the European Commission. This is important because it demonstrates that some adult leaders actually are listening to the next generation, that we want to make this an intergenerational dialogue. So I'm going to move now into the videos.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Adelaide Charlier. I am a human rights and climate activist from Belgium. I'm very honored to participate in this event today. I really wish I could be there lively with you, but I'm sorry I cannot be. Earth Overshoot Day is a very important day. It is a mirror to our society. It is a mirror to the action that we are taking facing the climate crisis. And today, it might sound like it's better than last year because it's a bit further away in the year. But sadly, it's actually not good news, I'm sorry, because the main factor why this day was pushed so far is maybe because the entire world was in lockdown. And that's not a solution facing the climate crisis. But what is a solution is putting everything that is destroying our planet in lockdown. Stopping fossil fuel, reducing our energy production and consumption, etc., etc., etc. So that needs to go in lockdown as soon as possible, because every single day after this Earth Overshoot Day, we are going to have to face the consequences. And a lot of people are already seeing the consequences of those days. So there's a huge part of injustice in here that we have to take into account. Because as Europe, we have a huge responsibility. You know, us youth, we are a lot of time told, you give us hope. But you know what gives me hope? When responsible leaders take action and take strong and brave action facing the climate crisis. I hope this happens very soon. I hope we can go further than where we are today, because next year, I'm very scared this Earth Overshoot Day will be earlier than this year.
Hey, I'm Leonie Bremer. I'm a Fridays for Future activist from Germany, and I'm fighting for climate justice. And since then, I have to repeat always, over and over again, that we have to stop the reduction of the CO2 budget. The problem is that I could live naked in a forest, not consuming anything, but my CO2 footprint would not be zero, and this is why we need a political framework. The political framework, however, does need politicians that are not just accepting that there is a 1.5 degrees of global warming target, but politicians that really act based on the IPCC report, and as I no longer want to live on the costs of other people living in the most affected areas by the climate crisis, we will raise the pressure until we have a political system which is based on the 1.5 degrees of global warming.
We are fed up with symbolic climate action. That's why we started striking on Fridays in winter 2018. We were joined by 100,000 across Switzerland and millions worldwide. We strike against polluters, greenwashers, and irresponsible politicians. We strike against the system, valuing our economic benefit more than nature, human lives and dignity. We stand up for a climate-positive society and economy, for a world incorporating climate justice and taking young people serious. We call for uniting behind the science, and science is crystal clear since many years, in fact. The latest IPCC 1.5 special report made it inevitable. We need a rapid and unprecedented transformation. The Earth Overshoot Day as well reminded us since 50 years, every single year again, that we are running out of time and that we are running out of resources. Climate solutions are here. Move the Date by Global Footprint Network, the Planetary Emergency Plan by the Club of Rome and the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research, or Drawdown with its 100 solutions to reverse the climate crisis. There are countless indigenous and local solutions as well. But the global elite decided not to listen and not to act. And I honestly nearly gave up. But the health crisis with Corona now showed me, yes, we can. Society can transform and change behavior within days. Politicians can act responsible, at least most of them. The world can unite, and adults in leadership positions can act according to the science and act like adults if they have to. So this gives me hope. But this crisis is not the solution. It's rather another alarming signal. And we are not resilient enough to survive this climate crisis. The COVID crisis, nevertheless, gives us an unprecedented opportunity. It's hard to change a running system, but now the virus took the emergency brake for us. Now we have the choice to invest in a future in line with the Paris Agreement and the IPCC 1.5 report. We are still here, and we are still watching. We are demanding a planetary emergency, a plan to be net zero by 2030, and incorporating climate justice in all decisions. A climate-friendly world is as well a more just and thriving world for us and the future generations. My name is Marie-Claire, I'm from Switzerland, I'm a climate striker and climate advocate, and I'm really happy to be able to join you here today to make the right decisions for a sustainable future. Thank you.
Incredibly inspirational videos, and I don't know if any of you had a bit of pang to your heart and a bit of emotion in hearing all of these fabulous women and their determination. Before I turn to you, Bertrand, and Frank wanted to join us actually from the BMW Foundation. The BMW Foundation is doing incredible work in becoming what they now deem is necessary low carbon mobility suppliers rather than automotive suppliers. And I think that what I want to add here, though, which is very important as we transition into the role of business and transformational innovation that Bertrand, you've been leading, is to think about the responsibility that these youth have taken over. One of the issues that I've spoken to many of the representatives, including Marie-Claire and also Adelaide, over the last months is that they need to share that responsibility. This is not just their burden. It is our collective burden, which is exactly what Marie-Claire says. So within that, taking into consideration the incredible role of transformational change, what we've seen communities do over the last months in COVID, changes in the way in which they have behaved. Bertrand, what is your thinking now as we're moving into this very important point in time where we really can transform? This is our opportunity.
Yes, hello Sandrine, and hello to everyone. You know, when I read the emergency planetary plan, I found it brilliant. I thought it's obvious that we have to implement it. But nevertheless, we are within ourselves. The people who really destroy the environment are not thinking the same. They are not in this YouTube conversation. They continue to destroy the planet because they have an immediate advantage in doing so. They earn money, they earn power, they have control. And these people have to be motivated, which means that we have to change the storytelling. We need arguments that can convince the people that we really have to touch. And there are a few things I'd like to share with you. I believe that the first thing is that we should not focus only on climate change, because climate change, melting the ice in the South Pole in 20 years, is not tangible for people who want to make immediate profit. We need to speak much more about pollution. Air pollution killing 7 million people per year. It can be your brother, it can be you, it can be your child. This is something that is tangible. we need to speak about the danger for quality of life of what is happening today, not just for the environment, but for human beings. We have to speak about the scarcity of the resources. If we waste resources, we're going to have a lack of material for our development. This can touch the people much more. Another thing I'd like to say, green is very much associated to political left wing in a lot of countries, which means that I believe that instead of always speaking of green recovery, we should speak much more about efficiency. Because we are in a society of waste. We are wasting 75% of the energy we produce, half of the food, half of the natural resources. So efficiency is something that everybody can understand, because if you are more efficient, you will be more profitable and you will touch the people who don't care about the environment, but who care about their money. So this term of profitability is important, and this is exactly what we do with the Solar Impulse Foundation, to identify solutions that protect the environment in a financially profitable way. And we have identified and labeled today 652. 652 proves that protecting the environment, being efficient, brings more money than wasting the resources and destroying the environment. Which brings to the question of growth. If we tell to the population, to the corporations, to the governments, that we have to aim for degrowth, we will never win. Degrowth is what happened in the last 4 months during the COVID lockdown, putting everybody on the knees, hundreds of millions of people unemployed, and hundreds of thousands of companies bankrupt. I don't believe in degrowth. But of course, since the Club of Rome report in 1972, when I was a child, it's clear that unlimited growth does not work. Infinite growth does not work. So we have to aim for qualitative growth. Qualitative growth is when you have an economic growth. You earn money, you create jobs by replacing what is polluting by what is protecting the environment. So you have the degrowth in the waste. You have a degrowth in the crazy behavior of the people. But you have an economic growth, giving jobs and profits to more people. And I believe that these type of things have to be understood by the one who are able to understand it. But for this, we have to explain it better. We need a narrative that is much more convincing. And for the people who nevertheless will not change anything, because they are so selfish, they are maybe so psychopathic, that they will only care about themselves. In this case, it's clear that we need a legal framework, extremely clear. And I think that the Green Deal of the European Commission today is a very good example of it, of how we can implement this emergency planetary plan, worldwide. So this is what I wanted to contribute to say. Let's not just give arguments where we are happy together, give arguments that will convince and motivate the people who are not yet convinced and motivated in the rest of the world to act right now.
Thank you so much, Bertrand. And I think what I will do is build on what you've said and also answer some of the questions that are coming in. The first is around the degrowth. You're so right. And in particular, also, you're right of the fact that we need to convince more people to come on board. The Club of Rome very much believes that there are different scenarios for prosperity, and that growth doesn't necessarily mean greater happiness or well-being across our society. That does not mean, however, that we don't want to have economic activities continue, that we don't want to have thriving communities, that we don't want to have access for more people to all of the essentials that they need, which, by the way, we do not see today with a GDP and growth scenario. So equity, more equitable distribution of wealth is fundamental. And coming to the storytelling, I would take it one step further. We now have the data that demonstrates that actually we can do things differently. We can decouple. the European Union has started to decouple its economic activities from pollution, from emissions. We now have examples of the donut economic model being put into cities that are enabling thriving communities to continue and thrive even more. We need to bring those examples together. And a question from several of you that are listening is, how do we get to a broader base of people? One of the suggestions has been very much coming from many of us who are also in communications. We need a Cambridge Analytica for good. We need, and that is not replicating Cambridge Analytica, that is ensuring that the data and the information gets to as many people as possible, that their hearts and minds understand what transformation actually means, that it brings hope, that it brings prosperity, that it brings good livelihoods and safe lives and access to health. And I think that in building on that, I'd like to ask Terry and Kurt in particular, because the European Commission is putting together its climate pact and looking very much at communications, as to how you see the way in which we bring this narrative to more people. Because we know this cannot be a fight between the gilets jaunes and those that are fighting for the end of the month, and those that are in the streets as the youth saying, this is the end of the world. We need to bring that together and say, no, this is the beginning of a world where people are equal and will have access to greater livelihoods and more distribution of wealth. Terry, Kurt?
I think there's many things we need to do. I would say one thing we need to do is surprise people. So the planetary emergency plan says we have to change entire systems. So it's no longer good enough to change individual things. To get Earth Overshoot Day to 31st of December in a way that works for our economy and society, we need to change our systems. So as a regulator, just in my specific role, I try and surprise people by saying, yeah, if you do the wrong thing, I'll give you a kick. That doesn't surprise them. But gee, if you want to be successful in running your school in a different way, in running a business in a different way, in running a city in a different way, I'm here to be a partner. I'm here to help. And we can add a huge amount. And if we all, that's a real test, because we're not going to change systems unless we do things that are really different to the traditional. So if I can't surprise people as a regulator by what I offer, I'm not doing enough. And that's really powerful to change people's mindsets.
Thank you, Terry. Kurt?
You're absolutely right, Sandrine and Bertrand. We need to go, as far as we are concerned, we are very conscious that we need to go beyond the Brussels bubble and not just talking to ourselves. And that's why we put some hope on the implementation of the recovery plans that will now have to be developed by all the governments, so that this can be a process which reaches out to the public at large. And we hope that the youth activists, for example, will play a very important role there. Some governments are already doing this, like in Italy, for example. It is very obvious that the European money, the money that will go to recover from the COVID pandemic, will only be allowed and authorized if it credibly contributes to the green and digital transition. We will not say from Brussels what exactly this should be. We will not prescribe it, but we really want the regions, the member states, to come with programs that the Commission and the other member states can then authorize, because we can claim, convincingly, that it does contribute to this systemic transformation. And we hope that this masses of money and the way they will need to be invested will help to create this public debate, and also a peer review by the scientific communities and clubs like the Club of Rome, to make sure that there is no greenwashing in these recovery plans, but that it is really a starting point for this transformation of our economy and society.
Thank you, Kurt. And I don't know, Johan, if you're still on, because I don't see you. But from a scientific perspective, I think the community, including the Club of Rome, has known that we absolutely need to be better at not just communicating gloom and doom, but looking at the vision of hope that we've been talking about in our planetary emergency plan through emergence. Do you have other thinking with the IPCC report that will be coming out again as to how we can better get the message of the scientists out there in a different way? You're on mute for the moment. There you go.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right, Sandrine, that I think there is, as Bertrand pointed out also, and I think that comes across in a lot of the work that we're doing today, that we have a double reason for frustration today. I mean, one fundamental reason for frustration, so well articulated by the youth here, is this unacceptably high risk levels we're facing. But we also sit on so much ample evidence that the transformation pathways toward a decarbonized future has all these multiple co-benefits, as you pointed out, Sandrine. And I find that to be a huge, self-critically, actually, a huge failure from the scientific community, that we have not been able to come across with the narrative, the narrative that I think comes through in a session like the one we're having right now, where we do not any longer talk about climate and biodiversity loss as an environmental issue of risk only. We're talking about sustainability as a path towards prosperity and equity. And I think that just that little shift in narrative is something that we really need to put all our hands on deck on. And IPCC has not been good at it. The IPBS has not been good at it. The Global Environment Outlooks have not been good. I mean, we have, quite frankly, not been very good at communicating this new narrative of sustainability as the entry point for success. And of course, we haven't been able to do that for such a long time, because it's only in the last 10 years that the evidence on food systems, energy, building, transport, et cetera, are falling into place here. But I think today, there's absolutely no excuse any longer. I mean, we just have to avoid this mantra on sacrifice to deal with environmental problems. I mean, that's what the skeptics love. That's what the conservative voices and the vested interests love, to always make the case that this is more expensive and it's always undermining development, which is complete nonsense. I mean, I'm with Bertrand here. I mean, I don't think that degrowth has any chance whatsoever if you want this to be a mass movement. But why can't we transform this into the most exciting agenda for success? And that's where I think Angela Merkel, for example, is starting to see the light clearly. And we have to continue that work.
And let's hope she sees the light even further after her 1.5 hour chat with Greta and the rest of the youth. So I'm going to start to conclude here, because we're already over time, and I hope that there's still many viewers. We had a registration of at least 300 viewers. So hopefully they're all with us, if not more. Let's just make sure that next year and the years coming, we triple, quadruple, even more that figure of people that join us on this journey and listen in. Mathis, there's a question here with regard to India. And I think maybe as I just bring you in to say a few closing remarks and then I will finalize, can you just tell us what you think the developing countries can do in terms of understanding Earth Overshoot Day, and also the shift, the link with the SDGs and other criteria to enable them to really start to move forward in a different way, in particular also in this crisis moment? I mean, we know that India has been one of those countries that has been so hit by COVID.
Absolutely. When we look at the world, we see primarily countries. Every country is a country, first of all. And I think the big shift comes, I think what Bertrand said is very important as well, is the big shift is not just about hope and despair. It's really about, can we help people see that they have skin in the game? It's about their lives. It's not just about being nice to humanity. It's about, if you're not prepared, you're not prepared. You know, and that will happen. So I think to recognize to what extent resource security is just essential for securing human well-being. I think that's what the message that needs to come out. And so I think that's true for any country. Switzerland, for example, uses about 4 times more than Switzerland's ecosystems can renew. Is that a risk for Switzerland? You know, if you start to recognize our countries as true farms and we keep them, we're stewards of our farms and say, that's our lifeline, that's our boat in which we sit, then I think we'll start to become much more careful and in tune. So I think the question is very well put. I think that as we see ourselves as part of it, we are not just viewing the game, we are in the game, then things start to happen. And that's why youth is so engaged, because they know they are in the game. It's not just theory, it's about their lives.
Thank you, Mathis. And we know that today is not just our event, but also The Scottish Government will be hosting an event, which I feel very honored to be part of, Terry, tonight. Please join in, those of you who have enjoyed and also felt that we have handled some of these questions properly. If you want to be more active, please reach out to the Club of Rome, to Mathis, and all of those that were on this call. May I just add my thanks, my gratitude to the team at Mathis's end and my own team here at the Club of Rome, Laura Till, and many others who have made this possible. And can I just say, when I finish, that the Planetary Emergency Plan, the new version, is up on our website. Please distribute it. Please get it out there. Kurt, I look forward to speaking to you more thoroughly about it. Terry as well, and other governments. And finish by indicating there were several questions here around the role of money and also around the role of the older population. So I'm going to try to weave that into my closing remarks. The fact of the matter is we need everyone on board. One of the things that Adele Aid again told me this week is she felt that the fact that senior citizens, that grandmas and grandpas were joining them on these marches was so important to them because it created that intergenerational dialogue that was so fundamental. They need to come in. Their voice needs to be heard, absolutely, in terms of the way in which they communicate to government and the way in which they work with other generations to say this is fundamental to change now. We don't have another 50 years. We are in a full world. A full world means we have 9 billion people. We have overshot that world, and we have shot us in the foot. We have shot ourselves so desperately in the foot. We need to take out that bullet, get rid of it, and start running. That's what we need to do together. All generations, all actors in society, and we can. That is the message of hope that this Planetary Emergency Plan has. We can emerge from emergency, but we need to be real. Any organization, company, government that has an emergency puts in place an emergency plan. We cannot now not put in place an emergency plan for our home that we call this planet, that we call this Earth. I wish you all a very good day, but don't forget to act every single day from here forth, so that next year we do listen to what Adelaide Charlier said very clearly. Let's not go back to business as usual and lose that time that we gained this year. But let's not do it through disaster. Let's do it by design. Thank you very much. Please continue on your journeys and bring as many people with you as possible.